Please rise as we welcome the Dr. Kiran C. Patel College of Allopathic Medicine Charter Class. Be seated. Please welcome Dr. Paula Wales.
Good morning, and welcome to the first pinning ceremony for the Dr. Kiran C. Patel College of Allopathic Medicine's charter class. In addition to my role in the college as Executive Associate Dean for Academic and Student Affairs, I have the privilege today to serve as your Master of Ceremonies. I'd like to start off by giving another round of applause for our charter class. Well, you've made it through the first 2 weeks of medical school. What do you think? Yeah? And I can promise it will get a little harder from here on out. But you are surrounded with a tremendous support system. You've got faculty, you've got staff, and you've got all of the loved ones, your friends and family who've joined us here today. And we all pledge to help you make it through this next challenging and exciting time in your life. Our forward-thinking medical school would not exist without our innovative curriculum and those who helped design it. At this time, I would like to ask our faculty to stand and be recognized. Our medical students would not be here without the unwavering support of their loved ones. I'm sure all 53 of you, right, had ups and downs on your unique paths to medical school. And I know that you are all a source of pride for your friends and your families. So at this time, let's all give your special guests here a round of applause. Now, I have the distinct honor of introducing our founding dean and chief academic officer, Dr. Johannes Wiefig. There's so much clapping going on today. It's very exciting. Dr. Wiefig joined Nova Southeastern in 2016. Since then, he's put together a team of experts and led the Dr. Kiran C. Patel College of Allopathic Medicine through the challenging LCME preliminary accreditation process in record time. Dr. Wiefig is a physician scientist with specialty expertise in urology. He trained and served at several prominent institutions, including Memorial Sloan Kettering Cancer Center and Duke University, before he joined the University of Florida. At Florida, he was appointed the founding chairman of the Department of Urology, and among his many achievements, he led that program to being recognized as number 18 in the country and number 1 in Florida by U.S. News and World Report. Prior to joining NSU, Dr. Wiefig was awarded a 1-year Jefferson Science Fellowship by the National Academy of Sciences. In that capacity, he served as a senior science and technology advisor to the United States Department of State. He worked on foreign policy as it was related to issues of global health and human security. Please join me in welcoming Dr. Vivek.
So good morning. Before I start, I was asked to show our video that shows our brand, who we are, and what we do, and I'm eternally grateful for Jeremy Katzman's assistant to get this all together in time. Please play the video.
The medical world is changing, while the way medicine is taught stands still. It's time to change the course. Welcome to a new perspective where science, medicine, and business converge in new ways. NSU is reshaping the way medical students learn through an active curriculum developed to teach them how to think differently. Our classroom reflects the diverse genetic pool of the world we set out to change. We're ready to tackle today's top health problems by challenging every assumption, looking beyond the data, to deliver a real-world impact. We are prepared for the challenge. It will be life-changing for students, for patients, for communities worldwide. The medical leaders of the future are emerging today, ready to dominate the health challenges of tomorrow. It starts here. It starts now. NSU MD, Dr. Kiran C. Patel, College of Allopathic Medicine.
So I wanted to point out that this video, everyone, every face, every body you saw in this video is either a student, a faculty member, a supporter, or somebody who is connected with us, and it all feels like family. And I think this is what it should be. The video shows, you know, our spirit, our character, who we are, what we do. And I have to tell you that with all the exciting festivities and events that we had set in motion here, this one is particularly special because you have, for the first time, the opportunity to articulate who you want to be as a physician, how you conduct your interaction with your patient. And I think this is all about values and ethics of medicine that I think Dr. Patel and I, and especially Dr. Hanbury, so share and value. So this is what this is about. I would like to honor some distinguished attendees of today's ceremony. Joining us today is the sixth president of Nova Southeastern University, Dr. George Hanbury. This medical school is one of the key visions and key components of Dr. Hanbury's and the NSU Board of Trustees' strategic plan and vision for the future, and we are truly grateful for their leadership and making this vision a reality, especially today. I wanted to acknowledge our leaders of the Health Professions Division and of NSU as a whole. I would like to welcome Dr. Barry Silverman as one of the Board of Trustees, or representing the Board of Trustees. Our new CEO, Vice President, Dr. Harry Moon. And Dr. Irv Rosenbaum, who I had the pleasure to work with for quite some time, as the new Vice President for HPD. Thank you for your help. We are also joined by two of the most altruistic humanitarians that I ever witnessed and met. The namesake of both of our medical schools, the NSU College of Allopathic and Osteopathic Medicine, the Dr. Kiran C. Patel, Allopathic and Osteopathic Medicine. Dr. Hanbury always mentions, you know, he's the only person who actually has named two medical schools, and we are very grateful to show the unity between the medical professions, and I think this is very important for us. We had a joint white coat ceremony where we all respect each other, where we came together, and I think this was one of the hallmark events of my life, and I truly appreciated that moment. Thank you. I also wanted to thank Dr. Pallavi Patel for being kind of the guidance for Dr. Kiran Patel. I can already see how this works in their family, similar to mine. I already know who the boss is, and recognizing who your boss is quite helpful. So thank you, Pallavi, and for your support. To our distinguished speaker, Dr. Sandra Gold, I cannot tell you how much I appreciate you making the way from New York City. I mean, whoever knows the Gold Foundation, Sandra is the key element. And I also wanted to thank Wilma. Wilma, you actually have been a real true friend who kept me straight. We have, a very deep relationship in terms of sharing values and what we do and what we want to do. And I wanted to... Dr. Wilma Siegel, so you can see my wife knows it better than I do, but that's, I wanted to just acknowledge you. Sorry, Wilma, you're part of our family, and I thank you for bringing Mrs. Gold down here to South Florida, so thank you for that. Thank you. So we are holding this ceremony, and whoever asks, you know, why are we doing this here, to empathize the importance of ethics and integrity in the field of medicine. NSU includes integrity as one of its 8 core values, and we as a medical school are committed to developing a value system amongst our students that exemplifies these values. Really important. Today, our student will recite an oath they have jointly developed in alignment with these goals, in alignment with NSU's visions, and they will pledge to follow ethical standards throughout their education, highlighting the importance of humanism, compassion, and collaboration for the betterment of each and every patient they serve. These values are synonymous with NSU MD, our school of medicine, as our charter class. You have the responsibility to stay true to those values and set the course for those who follow you. And next year, when we have another class, I think you are the leaders of that new class to bring that message to those who follow you. Very important. We're here to support you, and I think this, I don't say this, you know, because it's part of my script, but I think I pledge that we will take care of you on a very individual basis. So that class, and I think this makes the difference how you become the physician of the 21st century, and I'm so proud of you having you here, and I'm so glad to be here all with all of you, families, friends, supporters, and of course our students. So thank you for being here. I'm done, mic down or something like this, I'm not sure, dropping the mic.
Thank you, Dean Vivek. It brings me great joy to welcome our distinguished speaker, Dr. Sandra O. Gold. Dr. Gold is the co-founder and immediate past president of the Arnold P. Gold Foundation, which is an organization dedicated to preserving the tradition of the caring physician and advancing humanism in medicine. Today, students, residents, and faculty from more than 98% of U.S. medical schools participate in at least one of the Foundation's programs. Just to help you understand that a little bit, to get 98% of medical schools to agree to anything is a pretty big challenge, let alone getting them to agree to participate in something voluntary. So you know that this is a very powerful organization, or that many medical schools would not be involved. Dr. Gold's creativity, her energy, her vision, and her commitment to making the world a better place have been demonstrated through her service at the Gold Foundation and through her many professional achievements. Also, they've been demonstrated through her civic and philanthropic endeavors and leadership in many national and local organizations. She is a nationally certified counselor and career counselor, and she has so many accolades that I would have to reserve the rest of the day to tell you about her and to serve her justice. But having had the opportunity to get to know her, I think she's probably most proud of the work she and her husband, the late Arnold P. Gold, did in achieving incorporating humanism in medicine and in raising 5 children and 13 grandchildren. Without further ado, please join me in welcoming a champion, a true champion of humanism in medicine to the stage, Dr. Sandra O. Gold.
Good morning. That was such a nice introduction. I'm feeling like I have to work harder to be worthy of it. I had a very wonderful time last night getting to know the wonderful faculty and administrative team that has been developed for you, and I thank you for your hospitality and for getting to know Dr. Hanbury, Dr. Vivek, Dr. Silverman, Dr. Moon, Dr. Rosenbaum, and the Patels, and I am so happy to see you here. And there's somebody that I didn't get to meet that's sitting in the front row, and I want to meet you afterward. I say that because this is a very special place and a school that I feel already very close to, and you'll hear that in the prepared marks, and I hope you're not counting this as part of the 15 minutes you allotted me. Well, I'm very happy also, especially to meet the inaugural class of 2022, which is why I'm here, and to hear your oath, because all of that, all of this, the white coat ceremony, the pinning ceremony, is about that oath. My husband used to listen at commencement to the class taking the Hippocratic Oath, and he'd shake his head, and he'd say, "It's 4 years too late. They're already the doctors that they're going to be." And that's why the foundation created the white coat ceremony and the pinning ceremony. It has really little to do with your coat. The coat is the symbol of that oath that you worked on, and I can't wait to hear it. As the co-founder of the Gold Foundation, I'm deeply honored to have this privilege of addressing you at this auspicious rite of passage at the Nova Southeastern University, Dr. Kiran C. Patel College of Allopathic Medicine. It's a big, long name, and don't forget it, because Dr. Patel stands for everything that you're supposed to be as a physician, and his wife. There are actually dozens of things that I wanted to share with you today, but I think you'll be happy to know I've narrowed it down to 3. 3 issues in medicine that my late husband, Dr. Arnold Gold, expressed concern about and spoke to me about and were important, he thought, for medical students to understand and embrace. And so I thought that's what I talked to you about today. So I have 3 take-home messages. That means you're supposed to remember what I say. 1, understand the especially critical current need for leadership in medicine. You heard Dr. Vivek say this morning. The need for clear and considerate communication between doctors and patients, and the need for physicians to be the guardians of kindness in our society. Take home message number 1, be a leader. In the very first moments of speaking to Dean Paula Walsh on the phone when she invited me to come, it was clear to me that she and the whole administrative team under Dean Vivek were outstanding, and the faculty that has been assembled is outstanding to teach innovative new medical school education, devoted pioneers and spirited leaders in the battle for the heart and soul of medicine that we all know is being waged in our nation today. You have with you the people who can do the job. According to Aristotle, quote, "Education of the mind without education of the heart is no education." Students, as you seek to alleviate human suffering in the world, your education here at this school will prepare you for the future and empower you to provide optimal health care for your fellow human beings. healthcare based on excellent skills. No one wants a dumb, nice doctor. Collaboration and true compassion. Excellence in science, collaboration and compassion. Though I know little about you in the class of 2022 as individuals, I do know that as a group, you're very smart. You're leaders among your peers. And by virtue of having chosen to attend this innovative school, you are also have possession of a pioneering spirit, because you will be making new ground, and I'm excited to be part of this development as you grow and incorporate the mission and vision of this school. Bravo. So you're pioneers, and I learned that Nova is the only medical school in the country that has both an osteopathic and an allopathic school on the same campus. So bravo, you're in the right place. It made me think of Darwin when I heard the word collaboration being spun so much, because Darwin has a quote, and it says, "In humankind and animal kind too, the species who learned collaboration prevailed." So keep that in your mind. That doesn't come from Sandra Gold, but by the great Darwin. Arnold, too, was a pioneer. At age 12, his father died, and he was sent to live with a step-aunt, a woman not at all pleased to have her ex-husband's nephew in her home as a young boarder. Traveling alone by train from Brooklyn, New York, to Galveston, Texas, with an overnight layover in St. Louis, Arnold had to camp out at the Great Union Station there till the morning train to Galveston arrived. Based on many stories that I heard about his time in Galveston, I told Arnold that Cinderella had a better life than he had as a young boy there. He denied it vehemently. He thought it was great, even though, among other things, he was served different meals by his aunt than she served to her two sons. As a pioneering resident at the Cincinnati Children's Hospital, Arnold enjoyed being a physician in Mary Breckinridge's visiting nursing service in rural Kentucky, often traveling by horseback and rowboat to see patients. As chief resident in pediatrics, he became captivated by a new discipline called child neurology, being introduced and taught at the Neurological Institute in New York. In spite of his uncle Max, the doctor, who advised him, "Don't do it, Arnold, you'll never make a living," and whoever heard of a child neurologist, Arnold became the sixth licensed pediatric neurologist in the world. Yes, indeed, like you, like your faculty and your administrative team, he was a pioneer. And yes, he did make a living. Arnold was an exceptional clinician, researcher, teacher, author, and patient advocate for 57 years. He loved getting up every morning to see his patients, and he loved his profession. However, not everything happening in medicine made him happy. 30 years ago, at an age when most people are thinking about retiring, Arnold's visionary, pioneering spirit and leadership motivated him to establish a public charity, a foundation that bears his name, because the Board of Trustees insisted that he allow us to use his personal credibility as a professor of neurology and professor of pediatrics at Columbia University to confer that credibility upon the foundation's mission to address what he saw as an alarming negative change in the practice of medicine. The exciting explosion of technology and scientific discovery in the 70s and 80s had brought with it an unanticipated and discouraging side effect, a decreased attention to the importance of the human side of healthcare. During the past 30 years, the Gold Foundation has accomplished much, reestablishing the necessity for trusting relationships and caring in medicine, and for setting expectations for humanistic clinical practice early in the education of medical students. Now, as you heard, white coat ceremonies like the one you experienced recently take place at nearly every accredited medical school in North America and in 20 countries abroad, in Holland, Beirut, Afghanistan, Japan, Israel, etc. Just 2 weeks ago, and I got an email from the dean at the medical school in Quito, Ecuador, and it stated that they wanted me to come to their white coat ceremony. We didn't even know they had a white coat ceremony. And she said that they had it for 20 years and that the faculty feels that this is more important. And I have a quote from her. She said, "The white coat ceremony is more important than graduation ceremony because we are the mentors of our young students. And before giving them their white coats, we need to make sure that every day we use our white coats following the principles of good medicine." So what you're doing today has many legs, and you're part of something very big, new medicine. So the white coat ceremony and the pinning ceremony are part of many programs initiated by the Gold Foundation to foster humanism in medicine and set a gold standard of care of humanism and keeping medicine human, keeping healthcare human. So, class of 2022, today the noble profession of medicine is being redefined. Many diverse voices will try to dictate to you how to practice medicine. I urge you to stay determined to care for your patients as you envisioned the day you decided to be a doctor. For some of you, it was when you were 8 years old, like Arnold. And for some of you, it was 3 years ago or even 2 years ago after many other experiences in life. I urge you to take an active role in shaping a United States health system that is functional, fair, and humanistic. And I feel that this school will produce such kind of leaders who will really be impactful on doing that finally. Be optimistic and courageous leaders. If you aren't, who is? The successful experience of the Gold Foundation shows that impossible is only an opinion. Even though the foundation leadership was a small band of very, very busy business people and physicians, even though we had absolutely no expertise in cultural change agent work, and we had $0, even though experts in medical education circles, like Dr. Ken Schein, the immediate past president of the Institute of Medicine, warned us that trying to change medicine is like trying to move a graveyard. And Dr. Walsh intimated that too. Even though some of Arnold's colleagues accused him of smoking opium, the Gold Foundation forged ahead. We believed and still do that humanism and the desire to alleviate human suffering is a deeply rooted yearning within the hearts of doctors and diverse healthcare professionals. If Arnold, though a busy, busy clinician, author, researcher, and teacher, found time to write chapters in the two major textbooks at the time and still made time to become an effective change agent and activist, so might you. And as you're pinned on your first white coat and recite your oath, make a psychological contract about the kind of doctor you want to become, a lifelong leader, and if not you, who? Take-home message two, provide understandable and considerate communication in patient healthcare interactions. As physicians, most often you'll not remember what you say to your patients and their families, but they will be able to quote you even decades later. Because of Arnold's recent death, I have received literally hundreds of letters and emails from patients and parents, some who only saw him once, and that they confirm that point. I will read you one. Quote, "A horrific episode at 5 days old left our son Logan brain damaged. He was hospitalized for 6 weeks. The attending neurologist at the hospital said, quote, I wouldn't hope for much, unquote. I told him without hope I would never get out of bed in the morning. We were referred to Dr. Gold by a family friend. We took Logan to see Dr. Gold after he was released from the hospital. I will never forget how Dr. Gold entered the office blowing a duck whistle. Where is that? He talked to us about the state of our marriage, of our well-being, our young daughter's well-being, and then he took us to the light box where he showed us the films of my son's brain scans. Quote, "This part here," he said, "is very bad. According to this, your son should be deaf. But when I walked into the room earlier and blew that whistle, Logan was startled." So you see, this is wrong, and there is hope. Now take this child home and love him, unquote. He told us to get him in early intervention programs. He told us to take care of each other, and we did that to the best of our ability. He told us the challenges will be great and will try to weaken us. There are things Logan can't do and things he will never do, but he can do a lot of things which other doctors told me not to hope for. We are forever grateful for our time spent and from Dr. Gold, as he gave us so much love and lessons to carry through our lives. Words from a doctor matter. Be mindful of your words. One mother said, quote, "Dr. Gold gave me the worst possible news about Max, but in such a gentle, kind way that I actually felt relieved to finally understand what I was facing. Then he gave me a plan to help Max reach his potential as an individual with severe intellectual disability. He empowered me with his words. Max is doing really well at Camp Hill, and he is very happy, and so are we," unquote. Be certain, before you leave your patient, that they correctly understand what you have told them. My husband used to say, look in the eyes of the parents, and you'll know if they have other questions. And you stay there until those questions are answered. Be mindful that your words help and not hurt, even when you have to tell them very bad news. I always wondered at the patients who loved my husband's, because he often had terrible news to give them. But they always said that his relationship with them helped them get through what they had to face. That's your job. And the third and last take-home, err in the direction of kindness. Please understand that in life, and in particularly medicine, caring and loving kindness are greatly needed. Did you know that a statue of Aphrodite stood for all to see in the courtyard of Hippocrates? It represented the deep commitment to the very special, caring, loving relationship between the doctor and the patient. You know, in the old days, doctors never used the word love. Isn't that true? For the people with gray hair. But today, you can use the word love. The Surgeon General used it in a big speech a couple of years ago. For more than 2,500 years, the importance of humanism among doctors, colleagues, and their patients survived. In fact, until the 1970s, another popular saying attributed to Hippocrates was, quote, "Wherever medicine is loved, there is love of humanity. Wherever medicine is loved, there is love for humanity." Well, now love for humanity is at risk, both within the medical community and in the society at large. Last summer, a group of teens in Florida deliberately withheld all help, including no call to 911, to a man drowning in a local pond. How many people know about that? A few. They mocked and videoed his struggle and his death. I've been haunted by that deed, and recently read in the last 2 weeks that after deliberating the case, the Florida court system completely exonerated the group of teens because there is no law which requires the mutual obligation to help another person in such situations. The antidote to this extreme example of lack of kindness and an absent moral compass is you. I call upon the medical community, a community bound by oath to improve, protect, and preserve health and life, pledged to alleviate human suffering, to be the guardians of kindness in our culture and the role models for a commitment to the mutual obligation to help our fellow citizens, when possible, in our civil society. You are the remedy, and you are the cure. No pressure. Remember Hippocrates' saying, wherever there is love of medicine, there is a love of humanity. I want to end this charge with a plea that is memorable to me for attention to greater kindness from author and Syracuse University professor George Saunders, which he made at a convocation several years ago and has touched me deeply. He was asked to give this convocation address, and he was thinking about what is he going to write about when an old codger gets up to talk to young kids who are, you know, raring to go and has a big future. And he thought about it, and he said, so what do I regret? Being poor from time to time? Not really. Working terrible jobs like knuckle puller in a slaughterhouse? And don't even ask what that entails. No, I don't regret that. Skinny dipping in a river in Sumatra, a little buzzed and looking up and seeing like 300 monkeys sitting on a pipeline pooping down into the river in which I was swimming with my mouth open naked, and getting deathly ill afterwards and staying sick for the next 7 months? No, not so much. But here's something I regret. In seventh grade, this new kid joined our class. In the interest of confidentiality, her convocation speech name will be Ellen. Ellen was small, shy. She wore these blue cat's eye glasses that at the time only old ladies wore. When nervous, which was pretty much always, she had the habit of taking a strand of hair into her mouth and chewing on it. So she came to our school in our neighborhood and was mostly ignored, occasionally teased, "Your hair tastes good," that sort of thing. I could see that this hurt her. I still remember the way she'd look after such an insult, eyes cast down, a little gut kicked, as if having just been reminded of her place in things. She was trying as much as possible to disappear. After a while, she'd drift away, hair strands still in her mouth. At home, I imagined after school, her mother would say, you know, "How was your day, sweetie?" And she'd say, "Oh, fine." And her mother would say, "Making any friends?" And she'd go, "Sure, lots." And then they moved. It was no tragedy, no big final hazing. One day she was there, and next day she wasn't. End of story. Now, why do I regret that? Why, 42 years later, am I still thinking about it? Relative to most of the other kids, I was actually pretty nice to her. I never said an unkind word to her. In fact, I sometimes even mildly defended her. But still, it bothers me. So here's something I know to be true, although it's a little corny and I don't quite know what to do about it. What I regret most in my life are failures of kindness. Failures of kindness. Those moments when another human being was there in front of me, suffering, and I responded sensibly, reservedly, mildly. Or to look at it from the other end of the telescope, who in your life do you remember most fondly with the most undeniable feelings of warmth? Those who were kindest to you, I bet. It's a little facile maybe and certainly hard to implement, but I'd say as a goal in life, you could do worse than try to be kinder. To the extent that you can, err in the direction of kindness. Conclusion. May you enjoy your life as a physician and be a blessing to your patients and all who know you. Always try to be kind and skilled as a doctor. You want to be the doctor who you would want to take care of your mother, your father, your loved ones, children, people that you care about. Be the kind and skilled doctor you would want to take care of you if you became ill. And last, in the memorable words of that eminent physician, Hawkeye, from the TV show MASH, who articulated some years ago at a Columbia University College of Physicians and Surgeons commencement, and I quote, "I hope you will always remember this. The head bone is connected to the heart bone, and don't ever let them come apart." So, wear your white coat and your pin well. Enjoy your journey. And I can't wait to hear all the things that you as leaders will accomplish. Good luck.
Thank you, Dr. Gold. That was a great reminder of the reason we're all here to serve. Now, I'd like to invite Dr. Kiran C. Patel and Dean Fevig to join us on stage. I'd also like to welcome our Assistant Dean for Admissions and Student Affairs, Donald Pritchett, to join me at the podium.
Thank you, Dr. Wells. We are honored to be joined by Dr. Patel and welcome all of the honored guests here with us this morning. Today, our students will receive pins from the Arnold P. Gold Foundation. These pins represent the importance of care and compassion in medicine. Each of our 53 students has proven they have the knowledge and intellectual capabilities to pursue one of the world's most noble professions, medicine. As Dean of Admissions, I can tell you, we look far beyond these attributes when accepting this particular class. We look for empathy, reasoning skills, compassion, and humanism, all of the intangibles that make great doctors great. I would like to call upon the first row students to come ascend to the top of the stairs. As I read your names in groups of two, please ascend and pin your classmate. Dr. Patel and Dr. Fevig will also present you with a special gift. Christina Antuna Parvir Ajlu. Muhammad Ali Awan and Neha Bapatla. Shadi Bajur and Mitchell Bourne. Brad Bozerup and Piero Carletti. Zachary Carroll and Soteris Hanekotakis. Nafisa Chaudhry and Brianna Kakuza. Caitlin Kakuzo and Snigda Dawes. Romani Harkis and Haley Ehrlich. Kyle Huntley and Stephen Hartman. Victoria Ip and Mashtura Hassan. Shivani Kashol and Hannah Landsberger. Chase LaBeast and Becky Lee. Amy Liu and Samantha Marazita. Congratulations. Now, I would like to welcome Dr. Suzanne Templer, who is representing our learning community mentors, to call the next group of students.
Thank you, Dean Pritchett. It is symbolic that our students are pinning each other close to their hearts, because that's what these pins represent. I'm now going to call the next group of folks. Ready?
Ready.
Matthew McGivory and Evan McElroy. Stephanie Pearson and Eliza Manyaya. Joshua Raber and Joel Mintz. Samuel Rainey and Uvera Musin. Uma Devi Ramatar and Jackie Nguyen. Noreen Rashid and Jeremiah Oja. Nasir Siddiqui and Connor Oslin. Harman Singh and Jacob Oster. Mason Sutherland and Luis Santiesteban. Therese Vidal and Brendan Sen Crow. Reed Bennett Wise and Adam Shear. Alexa Nguyen and Sydney Stillman. And last, but certainly not least, Eric Carlton Young, Caitlin Williams, and June Lee. Congratulations, and thank you, Dr. Patel and Dr. Fevig, for being part of the special ceremony. Since classes began about 2 weeks ago, our class has been actively working together on developing an oath that aligns with NSUMD's mission and vision and emphasizes the values of integrity and ethics we have discussed today. When asked to identify a class representative to lead the oath, the students requested to express their solidarity as the charter class and read it as a group. This class is truly remarkable and clearly demonstrates the spirit of humanism in medicine. I would like to invite the students to take your places to recite the oath. It's now time. Is everybody ready? Please recite the inaugural class oath. Thank you, students. Please return to your seats and remain standing.
You may be seated. Great job. I'm standing back here trying not to cry. I don't know if everyone knows. These students wrote that oath themselves over the past 2 weeks. They spent countless hours together, and they came together as a team. And I hope that the pins that you're wearing are a constant reminder, ever present in your life, about the oath that you just made in front of everyone here that you love and in front of your colleagues and your faculty. So, you know, to end this, I guess I'll just say I've worked in medical education for a little over 2 decades. This is the part where the audience gasps and says, "Really? I can't believe it." No. But I have worked in medical education for over 2 decades, and I can tell you there's something really special, I mean, really special, about this charter class. And I'm just thrilled that you're all here with us today. So congratulations to the class and to all of your loved ones who are here with you today. So this concludes the formal portion of today's pinning ceremony. I'd like to invite all our guests to join us for a reception in the atrium of the Carl DeSantis building. Our staff will now direct our guests to the exits, and I'd like to invite the students to stay for a group photo. And once we do the group photo, you'll be released to join your loved ones. Thank you all.